airstrikes in northern Iraq. They're stuck between Iraq and a hard place, you know, because it's supposed to be called the land of peace, Iraq, but what happens is it turns out to be the opposite. But here you have France stepping in. They're old hands at this. They want to work together with the United States. It's the two revolutions, the French Revolution and the 1776 brand, which was distinctive to the instincts of Northam and its clan. Now, here's what you got. It's these folks began to realize they made some progress, as people do over a period of history. It's not just people; it's other things. Let's see. What else is making progress? Let's see. Yeah, raccoons in the city. Their brains are changing. Some folks were able to do a study on that, and they found out the raccoons are adapting. The city raccoon has a different brain structure. So, you know, is a big brain a good thing? Just have a look at what the human beings have done to the planet. So, that's what happens when you plan it. Anyhow, so we got this the French and Iraq. Now, a little bit of history. You had the period of European colonialism, and what happened is you had the most, probably one of the most ancient real estates on the face of the globe, and that was Mesopotamia, between the two rivers, the Tigris and Euphrates. So it's the crater of civilization. It's like the whatever scenario where you have Babylon out there bleaching in the sun. But people began to realize that, and you know this keeps being forgotten. People realize the ulterior motive of not religion but religiosity. There is a kind of a sequence in the brain that causes people to be. To behave in a way that they normally wouldn't, and a lot of Machiavellian scenario people would have realized through history that it is possible to manipulate these things for their own end, and they didn't get vaporized on the spot. Stuff did happen to them, but that's another study for another time. So here you have the 76ers, and finally the French Revolution, beginning to realize, you know, if you have a state religion, it can be manipulated. But let me tell you a little kind of insight here. The state religion is money. And always has been. The belief system of the people is money. They put their money on something, almost like a gambling instinct. So, is it money or is it something else? If you do the science, you may find out that it's euphoria. That's what people are, you know, the 76ers put in pursuit of happiness in the clause, and you know, it's actually the pursuit of euphoric scenarios. I'm trying to think of the one of the what's it, the it's called endorphin or something like that, where the body produces its own heroin or something, or heroinic reaction. Certain receptors get filled and say, this is where I want to stay, you know. So, you know, people are involved in two things. They you know, they're either involved in the pursuit of feeling good or in this the pursuit of fascination, where they just got to do something, pull it off, and say,
wow, that is so cool.
You know, or whatever the saying is for the day. I guarantee you, that is cool, man. It's not going to last. And can you guarantee me that? When does cool become the gruel for the fool who, you know, became the tool of the uncool, where they ran out of fuel? You know, so let's have a look at this, because this is fascinating. Here you got these guys who realize, now, first of all, back to that little section of history, you know, you had the, you know, hoop-la-la, whoop-yoo-pee type, you know. Europe. Now, European guys are really, if you look at it, it's Tangia. And they're part of the original Tangia of Asia. And they're the guys out on the coast, you know, Western Asia. You know, where the Gulf Stream kept him from having to wear gloves in the winter, except during the Grand Froid in France, you know, where, you know, what rhymes with France? It's like, we better not get that, go there. All right. So what we got here is we are going to make us, you're going to state what kind of mint you got. You're going to make a statement. Let's see what we got here. All right. These guys got together after World War I, and now there's this vacuum that there was left from the departure of the Turkish Empire, you know, Ottoman and his group. And this ancient Mesopotamia, where these folks... you know, they were between these two rivers, and it's not like the Nile, where the flood was docile. But out on the other plain, Tigris and Euphrates, you didn't know whether or not you'd get washed out in a flood. So instead of a Nile, they got annihilated. And this annihilation led to a genetic trait of insanity with the people. You know, you're getting wiped out by floods. The next thing you know, you're making little clay statues and saying, well, maybe I can get through to some higher ups up there who can do me a few favors if we do this and that, you know, and go through this rigmarole. And the next thing you know, you have religio. Now, religio is like the spin on a yo-yo. It always comes back into the hand of the one that sent it, if they know what they're doing. And that's not higher-ups, it's just simply some human being that said, the lightning will strike on the fourth day of the armpit of the Yeti in the spaghetti of... the Neti, and they say, oh man, he's the man, let's go do whatever he says. Build me a ziggurat. Okay, whatever you say, you're the boss. We don't want to get that. So yeah, but you know, the next thing you know is people are governed by this fear of the unknown, and it always has played into the hands of we call it the micromanagement. You know, a couple of nutty guys from each generation, or each, like, 10th generation that say, that they want to rule the whole entire third rock from the sun. And that's because these guys, if there was any higher-ups for them, their higher-ups were lying to them because they didn't tell them, hey, the third rock from the sun is like a piece of useless real estate. It's just so small. It was like a little garden, of terraforming in the midst of this huge clash between galaxies, you know. And by the way, you're headed for the next galaxy over, and you think you got a pathway of milk here because all you see is like stars in the shining through the blur of the dark matter, and the next thing you know, you're headed for this other one. The Andromeda strain is about to strain your brain, so don't complain. You know, so you get it, that's very simple. So Mesopotamia, and to this day, you've got these guys in Syria butting heads. You've got guys in Lebanon who are trying to sell Lebanon when, in times that are now gone, they used to be the Mon. You know, they were the Phoenicians that taught the Greeks how to read and write after the Greeks forgot their basic, what is it called, basic two or something? Their old writing that was started in that island, I think it was the Cretan Islands out there. This is fascinating. You ought to check it out because it's, you know, it's a thrill to get this stuff down into your brain, and you know, you won't be at a strain when things are no more plain than the last refrain on the bounding main. So what happened to these guys? Now you see what you got is you got France and England, and they developed this Mesopotamian section, and they call it, you know, Iraq. It was Mesopotamia. Iraq is like an Arabic word for peacefulness or something. But the next thing you know, it turns out to be the opposite, because now you have ancient groups clashing with one another. And you got this new factor in the equation, the economics shifts to oil. And everybody wants to have that oil field. And the next thing you know, everybody wants to have a theocracy. Because they're saying, well, we should be ruled by the great thing that has brought all this into being. But instead, what happens is the hustlers get in there. The hustlers get in, muscle their way in, and become dictators. And they say, well, this is pretty good. We got it made. And this is what happened with Saddam Hussein. Now, what happens is dictators behave. The word dictators become a bad word because, you know, that's a job for a deity. Unfortunately, what you have are human beings that slip into the post, and since they can't handle it, nobody can. People can't handle that. We're in an infantile stage in our development. So they go insane. You know, I mean, even the greatest minds that got into political activities, you know, people of renown, usually went nuts. They went insane. They couldn't handle this. Not one bit of it. So lots of trouble with Saddam Hussein. He was like, had lookalikes running all over the place. When he had his, you know, like relative Chemical Ali use the nerve gas on a village, that's what insane people do. He probably would never have done that. Okay, so now let's back up here. We got our history down, and you got France and England divvying up the Ottoman Empire, and guess what? It didn't work. Hindsight is 100%. We can see that the 20th century and the mess that this area caused, and the struggle for the oil. They're not struggling to own the oil. They're struggling to get an unlimited supply of the stuff for their people. It's the Hitlerian, oh yeah. Hitler says, hey, I will build Autobahn because it goes on this badly off. And he got the Autobahn. They said, whoa, look at that. We have connectivity. And next thing you know, we're going to have viability here. People will not use marks to light their fires. They will use it for investment instead. But then what happens? Oh yeah, we gotta make fuel. Let's work on it. We'll use synthetic rubber for gasoline. Uh-oh, didn't work. Why? Well, hydrogen is probably the most powerful stuff in the universe. I mean, you try mixing like calcium with chlorine. And, you don't get an explosion. Like what you do is when you mix hydrogen with oxygen, in order to make water, you also get this explosion, altered state. Pretty soon, next thing you know, the expansion is bigger in this area and everybody gets blasted. And that's not good for the human body. It's just like, you want to have a blast, but you'll have no fun. So, the hydrogen is, and besides, it's so limited because all the hydrogen on the Earth can escape into outer space. How can they do that? They don't have a space shuttle. It's because, it's not as you think. Everybody thinks uranium, 235 and plutonium, other things there, that's got to be the most powerful thing. It's so heavy. Look at that, man. Look at that, that block of gold, it's so heavy, try to pick it up. Hey, this weighs 50 kilos. Yeah, yeah. It's a famous novel from the, mid-20th century, 2 kilo mockingbird. They're saying, ha-ha, you think a noble means kingly? It means boring. Next thing you know, you've got the U-235, and it goes ahead. And, boom, and Oppie, baby, Oppenheimer starts chanting the mantra of the destroyer of the worlds, because they thought the chain reaction would eliminate all of matter. So nobody would ever be able to ask them, what's the matter? Because there wouldn't be anybody left. And instead, somebody rained on their parade, so they found out that the uranium and the plutonium were nothing compared to the mighty hydrogen. So they got something like heavy hydrogen, which this dude knew everything there was, like, oh sure, I'll give you a real blast. Next thing you know, you got Ivan, the 50 megaton, the 50 megaton blast going off and da-da-da-da-da. This stuff happens every day, all the time, in trillions of stars out, even just in our local neighborhood. It's like trivia, baby. So you want the live wire? Let's check back to our Mesopotamia here. And, the hydrogen. Why? Because if you have a fuel that's liquid and that only behaves something when it gets sparked or compressed enough, you can put it in the cylinder. You don't need steam, the altered state of water, which is another hydrogen thing, to push that cylinder back anymore like you did in the steam engine. Would that still be a good idea, using LPG to run your steam engine? They already have them in these designer-type restored locomotives, but the locomotive is that they haven't improved the steam locomotive, which the 21st century steam locomotive would be totally awesome. In the first place, it wouldn't be so big. The only reason why they were that big was because that was the 18th, and 19th century when they began to use their measurements. And now they can measure You see, you've got your computer here because people can start measuring microscopic. You know, and they hit the jackpot when they said microsoftware, huh? And intelligent microchips. You know, it was like a chip off the old kabuki. And you know, Chip and Dale are no longer looking for, you know, acorns. They got other things, other fish to fry. It's not even Friday. Okay, so we getting back to this. You realize in Mesopotamia, you got a Potamic Bohemic there. Now it's called Iraq, and a whole bunch of other things. So what happened is the colonial power there began to have to quell people who wanted theocracy in their own type of monotheistic belief system. And, you know, it works out for good for these folks, but the problem is something the 76ers saw, you know, back in the first revolution, the North Am one. You can't have the state religion because somebody will be able to worm their way in who is not that belief system. And, you know, it comes in many flavors. And I'm not going to run through this, not even going to go there, because that would begin to step on some toes of some people who say no because they don't know which way to go. But, you know, eventually you get to the micromanagement. This thing is working its way into a global, you know, in search of euphoria, a euphoric preoccupiers. Now, pursuit of happiness, you know. Hey, listen, just about anything that's really worth something involves a little bit of privation, suffering, austerity, and that type of thing. It takes somebody very savvy who has had some experience to be willing to go into difficulty and hardship in order to get into a higher plane of happiness. And, you know, that does that sound pretty zen to you? I don't know. You know, you got to watch out. It can get very cold. It's somebody that goes to and fro, traveling all the time, become a frozen, you know? So, yeah. Here we go with this. The jets do a bombing. Now, everybody can tell you that ain't going to cut the mustard, buddy. I don't know how you're going to understand this. I can't even go there because a lot of people are going to learn the hard way. You know, you can't control it from the air. You have to have boots on the ground. And the only boot on the ground that's really going to work is the boot that is suited for the environment of the problem. And that almost always is the native boot. So if you give a hoot, you're not going to abscond with the loot because you're going to find out you'll be a microscopic newt. All right. So here you go with the advent of the Foreign Legion. The mystery is, you know, not enough soldiers. So they'll take any soldier from anywhere, and you can go ahead and join them and become the Foreign Legion, the tale of the Foreign Legion. And it became kind of a romantic thing. A lot of stories and cinema has been done over this throughout its time in the 20th century. The major clash of the Foreign Legion with the dictators was in the French colony of, the Romans got mad at Hannibal. It's Hannibal Land, actually. It's pretty close to the Mediterranean. So actually, it's almost European in a certain way. And Hannibal and his boys, you know, went over the Alps with their new toys and tried to elephant the Romans in the back trunk. And the Romans had to resort to guerrilla warfare, which they hate. They hated. But they became arrivederci Romans, and they managed to get Hannibal and his boys. And after that, they got so mad, they went over to this place, Algeria, the Algerian area. Algeria, the next-door neighbor, very small country, Tunisia, that type of land, became a major problem with the OAS. Now, there are a lot of OAS, you know. But this one was the... Algerian underground there that became more than a match for the French Foreign Legion and caused Charles de Gaulle, which was show to go to I think what did he do, actually disband it for a while? I don't know. It came back because you can't get rid of it. It's kind of like an entity that appears. Now you have France and the United States working together in this kind of new Foreign Legionism. Except the United States Foreign Legion is a different type. Here, I mean, when I was in the Army, I was working together with folks from different Hispanic countries that were getting their citizenship by, I mean, this is personal observation. I actually talked with these guys. They joined the Army, and that's how they got their citizenship in the United States. So basically, it's kind of a reverse Foreign Legion here. You'll find out that then Rome began to use other people to fight their wars. At first, it was the Roman farmer. We don't have time to get into that history. The whole big thing about the fall of not Rome, but the fall of the Roman Republic. Now, we have a United States, which is a new Rome, and we have this new Roman Republic here. And everybody pledges allegiance to the republic for which the flag stands for. But that republic can fall. It may actually be engineered to do that. But that's another story, another fill-in info for another time. I'm about to say story, but that this is not fiction, you know. This is the stranger than fiction, you know. So now you have the French saying, the bomb hits the target and forget the debt because they're all spaghetti. It doesn't work like that. And you've got the United States over there saying, well, we have our raptors. And we fly the raptors with little guys, gamers love to do this. And they twiddle their thumbs. And the next thing you know, we have strategic strikes. Sorry, Charlie. Boots on the ground. And that's what's going to happen. This is the next story. Why is this? I told you in this P.S., you are always going to have a Sauder. Now, a Sauder, I think, I got to look it up, though. It's off the top of my head. I think it was the Battle of Fallujah. They had this whole big honking battle against this guy, and then finally he decided to toe the mark. And... you know, but these people will, you know, and they have a sense of dedication to their belief system. It concentrates more in this Mideast scenario where these folks have been made beyond tough in order because there is always this struggle for precious water. And, you know, why... was the Middle East like that? It wasn't like that in the Mesopotamian era, because it, you know, you check the satellite. They had you know, they did a study of it. You know, the geographic survey or whatever it was called in the mid 20th century, where they said, well, in order to start our planetary exploration, we need to actually look at the Earth as something they could do. You know, low orbit satellites, and one of them went over with radar that could penetrate about 15 feet in or 25 feet into the sand, and they found river basins and everything right there. This used to be a watered area. What happened? Well, one of the things that happened was that the human being is a type of ignoramus that practices the art of desertification, usually overgrazing of livestock that are meant to be a part of an ecosystem. But because it's now a monoculture of, say, goats, for example, or sheep, even worse, they completely denude the grazing areas and they become a desert. So, the scientific study, I'm sure, will show that at least a significant portion of the desert of this whole North Africa was because of, you got it, Homo idiotica, Homo sapiens, and his desertification program. And it's going on right now in the United States. They took a fertile area, just the eastern section of the continental divide, these Rocky Mountains, and the great aquifer at the base of those mountains on the east side, on the eastward side, and they turned it into the greatest dust bowl in the history of the world. And they're doing it again. And they're doing it, I understand they're doing it in Australia. Why do I know that? I was standing in the second floor of a library in one of the Australian cities, and I saw the cloud coming, man. It was just like eyewitness to another dust bowl. And I can remember my first reaction was, well, maybe it's not so bad, because that's the typical human reaction. It's bad, buddy. It's bad. You better believe it. So what happens now is these people have belief systems, and this is happening all over the world. In all the major monotheistic countries, basically three types of monotheism, and each one of them wants their own theocracy. They want to report to a higher being. But basically, you can't do that with politics because, united we stand. Well, guess what? You're not going to stand, buddy, because none of these people are united. They are a mixture of people who believe and apostates who only believe in world domination. And as I said before, people say, gasp, uh-oh, this is like James Bond stuff, Goldfinger and all these other people taking over a plutocracy of micromanagement. The micromanagement will get your butt. Nobody, I'm telling you, it's just simply this. Is people who, whatever higher being does exist to these people, and the micromanagement, I think, is like polytheism or duotheism. Basically, what happens is they are getting shortchanged on the information because they want to dominate a piece of nowhere. Third rock from the sun in the Milky Way galaxy. They don't even have a decent name for it. I mean, they called the neighbor on Andromeda, after some kind of polytheistic story. But here you got this third rock from the sun, and you got the micromanagement obsessing over every little bit, like, the Tsar of Russia, peed in our backyard. Get him! Three or four generations later, they destroy all the Tsar and all his family. Yeah. Say, what is their problem? You want to control what? It's like, knock yourself out. You will be destroyed. You're going to destroy yourself. But in the meantime, you see, here you have all these belief systems, and they are being used not by believers. Look at Israel itself. Herzl. check it out. I'm pretty sure this is like, I still have to do my homework on this, but wasn't the guy an atheist? Surely he would have gotten excommunicated from his little group of believers. No, he becomes the hero. And I checked with some of them, and their elders said they told him not to do it. So, so if I'm treading on some toes here, it's because their feet are too big. Their feet are too big now. And they are going to get defeated by worlds in collision. What can I tell you? Like Velikovsky said, or as he said, the little blue planet is riding along with the Milky Way, and we are headed for a collision with Andromeda. So, you say that's like X thousand years from now. Well, and even when the galaxies collide, they don't get destroyed, but there's one hell of a tide, and some tidal pulls are going to pulverize things. So here you got the French jet saying, oh la la, c'est magnifique. Avant tout vaincre, on se trouve du fric. No, petit gars. On y va, petit gars. Nope. You're going to have boots on the ground. And I don't know, maybe you're talking sandals and camels, man. After all, isn't that the delusion of Camelot?